I'm really excited. We're so close to being able to actually put a lot of this autonomous stuff with the sensors and the feedback and the command center to work and get Rover to another attempt at his nemesis, my hallway and his way to the front door and out into the world. Let me show you what I've been battling. In the last episode, we talked about synchronizing Rover's four wheels with the encoders at his primary motors and getting that information up into the cloud center, into the command center in the cloud. Well, I ran into another problem, which were outliers. Basically, the way in which the Arduino communicates with the motor controller, the RoboClaws, and getting reliable readings, both for speed and for encoder values. Reading these values several times per second, once in a while, you get a value that's way out there. So for example, if we're looking at a speed of 10,000, we might get a reading once in a while of 1 million. And that throws everything off, as you can imagine. The RoboClaw motor controllers are smart enough to discard those anomalies in regards to actually performing the commands that we send to them. So if we say 10,000 and suddenly there's a reading of 1 million, it doesn't think that it already finished the 10,000. It's smart enough to get around that. The problem lies in the information that it's feeding back to us. We still get those anomalies. So how we interpret them, for example, knowing what distance Rover actually traveled, if we're recording those distances and those encoder values or the speeds, then it's throwing off our values.
In order to get around that outlier problem, I put together this process outliers function here. And basically what it does is it takes out any large anomaly. So right now I have it set at 20% below or over than the average of the other remaining variables. And I've got included a whole bunch of serial print functions here so that we can see how it actually processes the function or processes the encoder values or speed values, however we want to use it. So let's send over a short drive command to Rover here. We'll watch the serial output here, and then I'll stop it when Rover reports that the motors have stopped, and we'll take a look at what the process outlier function has done. So here he comes. He just let us know that he stopped. So here's the final motor speeds that were all zero, so he reported the motor stopped. The encoder values, we have a small anomaly in encoder 4. We're running at 12 volts right now, so a small anomaly is to be expected, actually. Here's our average. And we see that all of them were within the 20% variance of the average, so they were all included.
Rover claws off.
Here's Rover reporting that motor controllers are off. So the total driven is being calculated as the average of those four values at approximately 12,000. And the reason there's 12,000 instead of 10,000, which was our drive command, is that he actually slows to a stop. There's a gradual slowing of the motors, which is part of the programming in the motor controllers. So basically then the output says that the drive remaining is minus 2,000, which is basically that we went over our distance command by 2,000, which again, we understand why. And we can use that for determining whether or not Rover has completed the issued drive command or whether or not he needs to do something before continuing with the remaining distance that we originally issued to him.
Everything we're doing is to make Rover autonomous. The more that he can do on his own, the better. That's our objective. The information that he provides back to us, back to the command center and the cloud, is basically the entire basis on which we can direct him, guide him. So their reliability is critical. So you saw me use that kind of process outliers function to process the encoder values and for distance traveled and the speed values, but it turns out that I'm gonna need them for the sensors as well. But basically the sensors, they do the same sort of thing that the encoder values do. I guess that's probably typical of any sensor, really. An encoder is just another type of sensor. That once in a while you get kind of this anomalous value and it can throw everything else off if you don't have something in your code to kind of knock those out of the way and then work with what you have left. Let me give you a practical example using Rover's hallway as our kind of case study. So here's Rover's view of the hallway, and you can see that he's not facing directly down the hallway. He's facing currently at an angle, which again, why make it easy on him, right? So here's a sketch of what we just saw. So basically Rover is not facing down the hallway. He's facing off off the hallway kind of at an angle to this first abutment. So as Rover approaches this, of course, his front left sensor here is going to get triggered first, his middle sensor's gonna get triggered second, and then his right sensor may or may not get triggered at all. And by knowing which sensor got triggered at what point prior to his executing a stop command, we can then determine what to do next.
So as you know, Rover has five sensors so thus far mounted. He's got the forward sensor in the middle here, which is the infrared. He's got the two ultrasonic sensors at each side in the front as well, and then two more side sensors that are infrared. Right now we're focusing on, I'm trying to address all of them, of course, but right now the focus is just trying to get the readings communicating between Rover's Android tablet brain here and the command center in the cloud with in regards to specifically the forward sensors. So looking at the command center, we see that I've implemented some minimum values, and these are basically the minimum values that if the sensors read a value of less than that, then they should trigger some event. In this case, it would be the obstacle forward sensor alert that would have Rover stop. So let's take a look at how that actually comes together and send over a drive command to Rover. So what I'm going to do first is flip the forward sensor relay on. So let's send over a short drive command, and I'm going to block Rover's front left sensor here. And then I'm going to take my hand away. Rover starts rolling.
Excuse me, please. And then I blocked the forward center sensor. Excuse me.
Rover's running through various commands. You heard him speaking.
RoboClaws off.
He's turning off his RoboClaws. These are all part of the program that is in response to the sensor readings and the logs that Rover sent up to the cloud. Here we are on Rover's activity feed, and here's the drive command that we issued to him. And we see that before he issued the drive command, he let us know that he was waiting because of an obstacle at his forward sensor. If we expand for the details, we see that we're now using those limits that we set, that minimum value, to identify the fact that it was the front left sensor that was blocked prior to him executing the forward drive command. Then he started driving. We see here that there was a speech command where he said, please excuse me. And then we blocked his forward center sensor, which initiated this obstacle forward sensor alert from Rover. And we've got this marked here, as we can see, because it flagged that this value was less than our set minimum value. And then that triggered all these other events to occur.
A lot of stuff has to come together, but we're getting there, we're getting there. So when I blocked Rover's forward sensors, so whether it was the front left sensor or the center sensor, it triggered events within Rover. Rover then checked with the command center and then executed commands that were issued that are related to those events. Now, what we saw, however, were the default events. They're like actions that we want Rover to do if he's not doing any other specific program. So if Rover was executing a particular program that we had designed to tackle a scenario like the hallway, or the one that's been really sitting in the back of my mind, how to get Rover to drive into an elevator, spin around, face the other direction, wait for the doors to open, and then exit. So it's a very specific scenario that he would need instructions on how to respond to different events. Wait for the elevator door to open, then go out, et cetera, et cetera. So that's a type of program. If we want to have events and actions associated with programs, that has to all be programmed into Rover's command center. So let me show you how I'm taking steps to make that possible as well. Here we are back on Rover's command center, and specifically in the programs and events section. Programs are essentially a collection of commands. So in the case of the servo spin program, we have essentially a collection of four commands, each of which turns Rover's wheels in a particular orientation. The events, the event defaults, I should say, the commands or actions that we want Rover to take in response to particular event codes, such as 10,001, obstacle forward sensor, 10,009, emergency stop, 10,010, powering off RoboClaws, that sort of thing. So when Rover reports one of these events, we then tell him what the actions associated with those are, at least in default. What we want to have is the ability for Rover to have events associated with these programs, which I'm currently in the process of working on. But just to give you an example, we can pick one of the programs, so the servo spin program that we have here, switch over to edit, and then down here we can say instead of sending that that program over to Rover, we can associate it with one of the event codes, such as the 1001. So if we send that over to the command center, do a refresh, we can now see that the servo spin program has been updated with an event code, so that if Rover executes this program and he encounters this particular event, this is what we want him to do. In this case, drive forward, et cetera, et cetera. We don't want that to happen, actually, so we'll take that away. But that's the idea. So if we take a look at Rover's status page, and now flip the switch over to run instead, and we want to send this over to Rover, we're going to issue the program that says spin the oriented wheels. Actually, let's do the all wheels straight. So if we send that over to Rover, we'll see that his wheels are now turning one by one at each corner. And if we do a refresh here on the status page, we can see the all wheels straight program is currently running, and it says that there's 4 commands total. But if we continue doing a refresh, once Rover completes the program, it returns to a none default. So as you can see, there's a lot of stuff coming together, but it is coming together. We've got basically more accuracy with the outlier processing for the sensors, whether it's these sensors or it's the encoders on the primary motors. We're able to evaluate the accuracy of those readings, and that's going to help us really drive Rover and understand accurately from a remote location via the command center and the web, basically just like any of you could control Rover from where you're sitting right now on your smartphone. Now, in combination with what we're just seeing now with the ability to have events and actions associated with programs, such as the hallway or the elevator that I keep thinking about, we're really coming into a very robust algorithm to give Rover the autonomous capabilities that we ultimately want him to have. And all of that, of course, is in the Arduinos and in the Android program that is available to any of you. So whether you're interested in building your own Rover or just checking out what comes next for our Rover here, give us a thumbs up, subscribe to get notified of new episodes, use the comments down below on YouTube or over on Rover's site. We'd love to hear from you, comments, questions, suggestions, and otherwise, we'll see you guys next time. Cheers.